Assalamu alaikum viewers, welcome to yet another episode of the program Organizational Behavior. In today's episode, we are going to discuss the concept motivation. And we have with us our expert, Mr. Fawad Bashir, and the students, Amna, Alia, Bilal, and Abdul Rahim. Thank you all for being with us. Sir, I'll start today's discussion by asking you the very first question that comes in our mind, that how exactly do we define motivation?
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum. So far as motivation is concerned, as we all are aware of it, generally, the concept leads us towards any outcome in life. And so far as doing anything is concerned, the basic driving force behind everything is a motive. And that motive and the strength of that motive will define the level of motivation, that how much motivated we are. And if we define it in technical terminology, the processes that account for an individual's intensity, first of all, direction, and persistence of effort towards attaining a goal. Persistence is very important here, because we try to achieve something, what sort of environment may be around us, whether that is easier or difficult. And key elements are like intensity, direction, and persistence. This is the basic concept.
Okay, so there is this thing called hierarchy of needs theory. What is it?
Yeah, it is very popular theory of defining motivation. First of all, we try to understand that what are the need or motive levels. There are certain needs which are very basic needs, like for the sake of physical survival, or these are the needs which are not related with the human mind or psychology side of the thing.
Biological, basic biological
needs.
Yeah,
you
needs.
Can say that. And there are multiple theories defining the concept. And there are certain needs which are known as the higher order need. So basically, we have to define that what sort of motives and motivation is required based upon the need level. So there is a hierarchy of five needs. We know it, that psychological, physiological, safety, social, esteem, and self-actualization. This was the theory defined by Maslow as well. And the highest order need is known as self-actualization. And self-actualization is the drive to become what one is capable of becoming. And so far as the potential of anyone is concerned, if we'll try to achieve the fullest potential, then we say that we're trying to achieve the highest order need, rather, known as the self-actualization, knowing thyself.
So, what is theory X and theory Y?
Basically, these two theories are two extreme behaviors of individuals. One theory says that employees are not willing to do anything, people are not willing to do anything, and they are not motivated at all. This is known as the theory X, the assumption that employees dislike work, are lazy, dislike responsibility, and must be coerced or punished to perform something. Yeah, we know there are few people who are to be forced to do something. And theory Y is other way around. The assumptions that employees like work, are creative, seek responsibility, and can exercise
self-direction.
So we cannot say that everyone will like fall either in X or Y side of the theory. But basically we can say that we can judge a behavior by seeking upon the inclination, whether that is towards the X
theory
or towards
X
the
or
Y.
Amna, you have a question?
Yes. Sir, which theory, X or Y, is most productive to the organization?
Generally, the research shows that it generally depends upon the work setting. And the level of the employees, like at the labor level or lowest level, generally they pursue the lowest order needs more than the higher order needs. And if a person is more towards the higher order need or managerial people in an organization, they are inclined towards the X side, towards the Y side, because they're self-motivated, self-directed. And so far as the people who are focusing upon the lower order needs, they are like towards X side of the theory.
Who dislike the responsibility factor.
Generally.
Alia, what about the two-factor theory? Would you like to define it?
Sure. Two-factor theory is basically a motivation theory which deals with both intrinsic and extrinsic factors. Intrinsic factors are those factors which deals with the higher order needs, that is the self-actualization or the self-esteem, while the extrinsic factors are those factors that deals with the hygiene conditions or the work environment, whether these factors are favorable or not. Mm-hmm. If they are favorable, then they motivate the employee, mm-hmm. and if not, then vice versa.
So would you further elaborate?
Sure. Basically, the older concept was that either a person will be satisfied or dissatisfied. Mm-hmm. But the Herzberg's view was that there are certain factors which will satisfy the employee. Mm-hmm. And absence of those factors will not dissatisfy, but there will be an absence of satisfaction.
As in their presence will make them more favorable?
Yeah, okay. Definitely. Yeah, the employee will be more motivated. Mm-hmm. And there are certain factors known as hygiene factors. And the presence of them will be like necessary. And if they're not present, employee will be dissatisfied. Mm. But if they are present, employee will not be satisfied, but he or she will be like at the state of no dissatisfaction.
By hygiene factors, do we literally mean the hygienic condition of a work environment?
No, not at all. Basically, this terminology is used as certain, like Alia said, more towards the organizational factors like elaborated in the slide, company policy, administration, supervision, relationship, work conditions, salary, and relationship with peers, personal life, relationship with subordinates, status and security. Mm-hmm. These are the hygiene factors, and absence of these will dissatisfy an employee. Okay. But presence will not satisfy motivate. Satisfiers are like achievement, higher order need, recognition, work itself, responsibility, advancement and growth, more towards intrinsic.
Definitely.
So these are two things, and this is the latest, you can say, contemporary side of motivation theories, as Herzberg said, that these are two different set of like factors.
This is the most applicable one by now.
Sir, I have a question here, sir. As there are events of dissatisfaction and satisfaction, and how the comparison of these two lead us to some output, and sir, what could be the outputs in this?
As there is a strong relationship between motivation and performance.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
Okay, as a self-motivated employee or a motivated employee will be more productive, will be more satisfied generally. Mm-hmm. So the positive things which are required by an employee in an organization, like higher commitment, higher loyalty, higher productivity, higher performance, the chances will be more. So if an employee is more motivated and the organization is providing such an environment which is like conducive towards motivating the employees, definitely these factors, required behaviors, will be like towards the positive or higher side.
Existence, relatedness, growth, ERG theory is a concept. So would you define it?
Yeah. If we relate it with the Maslow hierarchy of need, as we already discussed, there are five needs and lower order and higher order need. We can simply say that ERG theory just, you can say, group them into three major needs. First of all, the existence, as we can relate it with the Maslow hierarchy, this is basic physiological need.
Presence of a human being, being possible.
And towards social need, the concept here is relatedness, desire for relationships. The third is growth, desire for personal development, higher order need. Definitely achievement, definitely
recognition,
definitely there might be a growth towards self-actualization. So these are basically three major groups in which we can like say that human behavior will fall within.
Bilal, there is this David's theory of needs. Would you like to give some input about it?
He's asking about the three dimensions of a personal or self-interest of a person in motivation, in which one is the need for achievement, the second one is need for affiliation, and the need of power. And the need of achievement is self-interest, or he want to achieve or success any goal and anything. In need of affiliation, he needs to build relation
with someone,
with someone internally or externally of the organization. The need of power, he want some power, empowerment to
exercise,
succeed or
definitely
make a great follower for his path.
Let me add, definitely you have defined it very well. need for achievement, as previously we have elaborated in previous theories, need for affiliation, we know it. Yes. But there is a new need, which he introduced, need for power.
Need for power.
If we look upon the history of the humans, this is the lust for power, I would say, is the most destructive need.
Bloody battles have been fought for the need of power.
Need of power. The need to make others behave in the way that they would not have behaved otherwise. Mm. Okay, this can be used positively toward the organizational betterment.
Definitely.
But so far as this need or a negative side of this need is concerned, if a manager want to control others for the sake of control, power hungry, then definitely this will be very disastrous.
Very disastrous. Amna, do you have a question?
Yes, sir. What are the characteristics that high achiever prefer in job?
Very right, very appropriate question. As the people who are more towards the higher order need, they want to achieve something out of their work, their life, they seek three things.
Mm-hmm.
First of all, the personal responsibility. They go for seeking responsibility on their own.
Mm-hmm.
Then they want feedback whether they are doing good or not. If they're not provided with the proper feedback, definitely they'll not know whether they are towards the right direction or not. And third is moderate risks, because either risk is towards the lower side or risk is towards the higher side, like in gambling.
Mm-hmm.
But they are not gamblers. Mm. They will go for 50-50 sort of a risk, because as the risk is low, there will not be a sense of achievement there. If risk will be high, that is gambling, and they are not like that.
Mm.
So if risk is moderate, there will be a sense of achievement as well, that people are not taking that risk, but they are trying to take that risk. So their sense of achievement will increase.
As well as their responsibility will not be harmed as well, or it will not be in danger as well.
Very right, very right.
Question by Alia, please.
So what is cognitive evaluation theory and what is its implication?
To you students, it has a very strong implication. Allocating extrinsic rewards for behavior that has been previously intrinsically rewarded and tends to decrease the overall level of motivation. As if you are reading a novel on your own, a story on your own, you will be self-motivated. But if that will become the part of your course, what will be your level of the
motivation? Will never be self-motivated.
Because now it will be extrinsically rewarded as a grade in your mark sheet. But previously you were trying to study that thing on your own. So
to please ourselves or for self-interest.
Yeah. If you're doing something to please yourself, definitely you'll be self-motivated.
Mm-hmm.
But if that same task will be imposed and you will be rewarded externally for that, will not be that much motivated.
Sir, how self-efficacy define the concept of motivation, sir?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Basically, theory of, first of all, we'll discuss the goal-setting theory.
Mm-hmm.
The theory that specific and difficult tasks or goals with feedback lead to higher performance.
Mm-hmm.
If a task is difficult, this will be rewarding an employer with higher sense of achievement.
Mm.
If feedback will be provided that you are doing good, then definitely it will lead towards a higher performance.
Mm.
And so far as self-efficacy is concerned, it is the individual's belief that he or she is capable of performing a task.
Mm-hmm.
So if task is difficult, self-efficacy is high, definitely it is a deadly combination, because that person will be thinking that he or she can do it, and he or she will be very much motivated because task is difficult. And sense of achievement is high. So there is a strong relationship between both, that if you are capable and you're confident and the task is giving you a sense of achievement, the motivation will be toward the very higher side.
So means the capability of an individual for achievement of a goal.
Yeah, capability as well as your own feeling and belief. Capability is another thing, you can do it. But the belief that you know that you can do it, definitely both
confidence
should be there.
Level.
Yes.
So what do we literally mean by the word efficacy?
Efficacy, as you know, that if I am capable of doing something, it can be related with the term I'm efficient, fulfillment of something, I can do it. So basically this means that.
Viewers, they say that behavior is a function of its consequence, and this is also the reinforcement theory. Alia, you further define the reinforcement.
According to reinforcement theory, behavior is the function of consequence, and it can be modified or reinforced by providing consequence. Like we have discussed the example of dog and ringing the bell and the salivation of dog for food.
Yeah, basically, as we have learned in the theories of learning, that reinforcement is very much necessary if we want to like stabilize the behavior. And we want to like bring in a permanent change in the personality. And same is the case in the motivation, that if that motive is not reinforced time and again, as being a student, you have a motive that after doing a professional degree, inshallah, you'll get a good job.
Yes.
And if that thought is not reinforced time and again, you'll lose your motivation.
And the flow and intrinsic motivation theory is similar, or it is different from it?
Yeah, basically, as intrinsic motivation and flow has a relationship. They say that you experience the flow, or flow is an experience arises more often at work than during a leisure.
Definitely.
Because if you're doing something,
the flow develops.
And that will be related with the intrinsic motivation. And so far as the intrinsic motivation is concerned, this is the concept which is like dependent upon certain factors. First of all, in the progress, the feeling of significant advancement in achieving the task's purpose. And if progress is there, and these all choice, competence, meaningfulness, and progress will like you can say contribute toward the intrinsic motivation of anybody.
But then again, sir, this is very important in an organization, that you see to it that what kind of person is being given the task, because some people avoid responsibility. They might be very good at doing it, but they are afraid of getting that responsibility.
We have time and again discussed the concept person job fit, and this is the scope of this
subject.
Definitely. And how to create that fit within the organization.
What are the intrinsic factors that motivates employee?
Okay. Basically, these factors which we have already discussed, these were the intrinsic factors like choice.
All right.
If it is yours, competence.
See, your question has already been
discussed.
Basically, if you have got it,
yes.
And progress.
Mm-hmm.
If you think, you perceive that progress is being made, then we can say that you know
that these are the factors. So, what is the equity theory?
Yeah, as the term suggests, that equity should prevail. Not only in the society, in the family, but in organizations. But so far as equity in an organization is concerned, it is more toward the perceived side of it. If one perceives that equity prevails, definitely it will be related towards the satisfaction and motivation. Individuals compare their jobs, inputs, and outcomes with those of others, and then respond to eliminate any inequities.
Okay.
Basically, if you are putting in more of effort, but the reward is less. Definitely, equity is not there in comparison with others. If someone is like getting more rewards, but he's not putting much of that effort, definitely equity is not there. Okay. So comparisons might be self-insight, that you will try to compare your previous job within that organization with the existing one. That's whether you have an increment in the reward or not. Self-outside. You might be doing job in some other organization as well, and you will try to compare that previous job in an outside organization with the existing one.
Okay.
Then the other inside, you might be comparing yourself with someone other.
Some colleague or someone present in your own organization.
At that same hierarchy level. And other outside, you might be comparing yourself
with someone working in another organization at your designation.
So these are four dimensions in which you will try to compare whether that equity is within the organization or not.
That in everything is based on self-interest, because there is no such thing as selfless. Everything we do is for our self-interest.
If we again relate it with the Maslow hierarchy of need, the highest order need is self-actualization.
Yes,
those are the people like Mother Teresa, Abdus Taredhi, these are the people who try to do something for the humanity at large. They go at that level of selflessness. They try to live their life for others. But most of us are not like that.
Yes.
We have our self-interest, and so much so we try to develop relationships based upon self-interest.
Definitely.
And if we try to say that platonic relationship is there, it is not so.
Yes.
Okay.
Sir, I have a question. Sure. How does equity theory motivate employees?
Okay, as we have already discussed, that if equity prevails within the organization, then if equity is not there, then definitely the employee will not put in all of the effort. And there are certain choices of dealing with the inequity by the employee within the organization. Either he will change the inputs.
Yes, definitely
need not to put in the more of the effort. Change the outcome. Basically, he will increase the output so that he or she will be rewarded more. Or distort, change perception of the self. He will like change the perception altogether and try to say that I am doing much of the effort and reward is so much, so need not to change the behavior. Or distort, change perception of others.
Try to make the others realize that I am not being rewarded well.
Or you made the comparison with others, and if others are not doing like that much of the effort, definitely you will try to give them a bad place in your mind, or you can try to relate that they're not doing what I am, the one who is doing what, sort of a thing.
Sort of a justification.
Yeah, yeah. Choose a different referent person. You will change the reference person, and you will try to make a new comparison. So that new comparison will motivate you more and leave the field, quit the job. So these are the options.
And what are the prepositions related to equity theory?
Okay. Basically, propositions related to equity theory or the research shows that if employees over rewarded, they'll produce more than equitably rewarded employees. A positive thing.
Yes.
Over rewarded employees produce less but to higher quality piecework. It might be so as well. Under rewarded hourly employees produce lower quality work. Might be so, or under rewarded employee produce larger quantities, so that but the quality will be low.
Definitely.
So if they'll be like producing higher number of like products, then there's a chance they'll be paid more. So these are the implications or propositions which can lead us towards like managing the motivation of the employees.
If we see equity theory, we will see distributive justice, which is a perceived fairness of amount and allocation of rewards in among individuals. And if we see procedural justice, it is the perceived fairness of process used to determine the allocation of rewards. Sir, if these theories are implemented, then how can we say that it is justified, because there is also perception in case of justification in the minds of individuals?
Okay. So far as the concepts we are discussing so far, their application or the extent of their application in an organization is concerned, when we try to figure it out, we ask from the employees what is their perception about it. So if we talk about the distributive justice or procedural, as you have elaborated, procedures are there and they are justified, and so far as their application or distribution of that thing is concerned, if that is justified, it will be like asked from the employees whether they perceive that justice prevails within the organization or not. So if organization thinks that this is an approach which is justified and based upon the justice, but employees do not think so, definitely there is a gap. And you might be thinking that justice is there, but employees are not perceiving so, then there is a gap. So we try to figure it out that what are the employees' perception about the justice, and if that sort of justice will be prevailed in an organization, definitely the employees will be more motivated, because he or she will think that this is a very just organization. So this is a very strong relationship with the employee perception as well.
Whenever in an organization employees are working, they have some kind of expectations, and then the expectancy theory prevails. Alia, would you like to define it?
Sure. Expectancy theory says that the individual's tendency to act in a certain way depends upon the strength of expectation that this particular act will result in this consequence. For example, if I say that if I will work hard, I'll get an A grade in this course, means the level of effort is associated with the strength of the expectation. Higher the expectation, then higher the level of the strength. It means that you are motivated by the expectation.
It means that the stronger the expectation, the stronger will be the motivation.
Basically, so far as this theory in organizational behavior subject is concerned, it has four components. First of all, individual will put in most of the effort if he or she thinks that this will lead towards the higher performance. And that performance will be towards the higher side if the organization will reward accordingly. And okay, and that reward will motivate employees much towards the higher side if that are that is related with the personal goals. Again, if an employee is towards the higher order needs, definitely he like will go for recognition more. And if an employee is towards the lower order need, he or she will be more towards the like extrinsic benefits, like financial side or other benefits of it. So
all these things are interrelated. Amna, do you have a question?
What are the dimensions of performance in organization behavior?
Very right. Okay, now we are almost towards the
end of the program.
End of the program and conclusion. Basically, performance is related with the three major things: ability of an employee, opportunity of doing something, and motivation, which we are discussing right now. So if ability is there, okay, and then opportunity will be there, and that person will not be motivated, definitely result will not be there. If an employee is motivated, ability is there, but opportunity is not there. And definitely, if anyone of all three is missing, definitely
the performance
will be towards the lower side.
Bilal, do you have
a question? Yes, I have a question. Yeah, how different motivation theories we have discussed affect the or how they are integrated with each other?
Okay. Now here we'll try to explain the concept through this very.
In fact, sir, I have to inculcate a question with it.
Sure.
That how these theories are applicable within organizations as well.
Very right. Okay, so I'll start from the Bilal's question. Basically, as all things are related with one another, we can say that none of the theory will exist in isolation. All the theories and concepts are interrelated.
Mm-hmm.
It will start from the individual effort, individual performance, reward, and personal goal that we have discussed it in the previous theory. It will be dependent upon the ability, opportunity, as we have discussed. Objective performance evaluation system should be there. Then reinforcement will be there at the individual performance. Then the performance evaluation criteria will be justified, justice theory. Then the intrinsic motivation, higher order needs will be affecting the process altogether. And the personal goals will be related with the dominant needs and the personality. So this is a very comprehensive model which try to inculcate all the elements. And so far as the second question by you, Komal, is concerned. Okay, all these concepts, as we have discussed them generically, but so far as we'll try to implement these concepts in an organization, we will introduce such a system which will first of all recognize that at what need level the employee or that group is or that team is prevailing.
Again, that job fit model.
And then we'll try to introduce such motives or motivating tools which will lead towards the higher motivation and performance. Secondly, we'll try to design the job as far as the work setting or industry is concerned, related with that particular environment and psychology of the employees. Job design can be we can enrich the job, we can give him more challenge. If that employee is challenge seeking.
Capable of challenge.
Yeah. So this is a very comprehensive model which we have discussed, that all theories are interrelated, whether that is equity theory, whether that is self-efficacy or whatsoever the elements of these theories are. So, so far as an organization setting is concerned, organization apply these concepts in an organization by changing the design of the job so that you can create a better job person fit by rotating it, known as the job rotation, that you will try to rotate employees within different jobs, enlargement, then giving a challenge to the employee, then enrichment, again job is more enriched, again challenging. And that change will lead us away from the boredom and job sharing as it creates flexibility within the job, because if two people are sharing a job, they can exchange the ideas and they can change the times as well that both are doing the same task. and then the pay should be merit based.
Mm.
Mm.
And there are certain like provisions like gain sharing. Mm.
Yes.
There are like stock ownership programs.
Mm-hmm.
So all these things are introduced in an organization so that overall motivation level of employees can be increased. So this is the application side mm-hmm. of the motivation
of all these theories.
Yeah.
Okay. With this, we come to the end of today's program. In today's program, we have discussed the basic motivation concepts and all the theories that we have studied. In the end, our expert has clearly told you how to implement those theories in an organization. I hope that by now you have gotten a fair understanding of the concepts that we have discussed in today's program as well as the previous programs. With this, I'd like to say Allah Hafiz.